So I'm sure as a hobby, just like every other hobby, cuisine too probably has its own limitation. But on a whole, I personally feel extremely fortunate to have probably taken up this hobby apart, like along with my curricular activities, along with my studies and all, like the fact that I could come somewhat continue, and the fact that my family were very welcome to do all these things, do whatever you like, even do whatever you feel like. The fact that I have been so sort of given that amount of independent space. So, cuisine has been kind of, what can I say, it's very difficult to explain in a sentence, but it's an entire world sort of to me. And the amount of the reciprocation, the respect, the recognition I've got through cuisine, and I believe that I'm very lucky even at that, at my age, I have actually seen some beautiful, beautiful people. Okay.
All right. Samanvay, a lot of people might not know that you also host a quiz in memory of your father. So how, so what's the story behind inception of that? And like, it's very different from the other kind of quizzes that we host, because we host for a college or a organizer. This is more personal. So how does that come into account?
Yeah, well, my father passed away. This was in 2012 on 28th April. So I had just appeared for my board exams, ICSE exams, and I was awaiting results. And so suddenly this happened on 28th April 2012. Now, next year, so we have these rituals and rites of, having that 1 year sort of thing where a priest is called and we are supposed to invite a few people and all. It happens at the 1 year thing or so. So I'm not quite a religious person per se. So what I thought was, why don't I try something new? So I was quite interested in hosting a quiz. I had been to multiple quizzes by then, but I had never hosted an open quiz, where everybody would come and participate. I had never done that. So I thought, okay, let me try it. And that also, the first time it happened was in my own school only, where I had grade 10 class 10. It's in Bhubaneswar. It's a nearby town. So that is where I went to the principal and said, sir, can I do something like this? He was very amiable and he said, okay, why not? Why don't you try something new? So he gave us this space and I tried to put on the, we had PPT and all. But so it was 28th April 2013, the exact date when it first happened, the very first edition. And so it was bang in April end. You can understand the sweltering Indian summer. What can it do? We had no AC back then. It was very humid, very hot, and there were two big fans. We kept as a standing fans for the participants. And every time I have to play the AV flues, I have to switch off the fan first and then go for the AV flue. It was some experience. Now that I am telling you, in 2020, it looks like, okay, it was some lifetime back. So, but what was the plus point was that, despite all that problems, despite all these handicaps, I had some 29 teams participating, okay, in a very hot summer afternoon. And I was really impressed. I didn't expect, I saw how many 8 to 10 people will come. I didn't expect that I would have to do a prelims, because nobody in the open circuit knew me back then. I was not regular in Calcutta quizzing as well. So most of these people who are regular suburb quizzers, These guys came and made this a huge thing, and it was a huge event for me, because back then I have been to some quizzes where I actually seen some 14-15 teams participating, and with that a jump to 2019 coming in, especially on a day like 28th April, was a huge thing for me. Now, so what happened in 2014, I couldn't do that because I was supposed to appear for my board exam, so I couldn't do that. As there were some joint entrance examinations also going on, so I had to chuck the idea. In 2015, when I joined, by 2015, I have already joined Calcutta quizzing regularly, the circuit regularly. So I've known quizzers in and around the city very well by 2015. So in 2015, I thought that, okay, I might try this in Calcutta, because people won't probably travel to suburbs for this quiz. Why don't I take this quiz to them? So I did that at Presidency University. So that was kind of a renovated, there was an auditorium, which was the AJC Bose auditorium that was recently renovated. So I went, got in touch with a senior from Presidency. And this kind of happened. So then I saw many senior people to come and come in, and they were joining the quiz. And there also I had some 80 odd people come in this. But again, it was summer. So I was very impressed. So these people gave me the idea, why don't I try it in a regular sort of a fashion? So from 2000, that since then it has happened every year. I'm not too sure whether this year I'll be able to do that. But in 2019, it had happened every year. And in 2019 in particular, this was extremely difficult for me to host, because last moment, the normal venue, these people told me that, you know, there was some kind of university visit. We cannot really give you an auditorium. That was last day before the event. I was like, my goodness, okay. So I called up one of my friends, and he kind of went through my contacts and managed a very small sort of auditorium, which is just opposite to that. And then one of my friends went there and did the booking. And by this, it happened. And, you know, at the end, I became so emotional at the end of this particular edition. I went around and wrote on Facebook that, you know, now this particular annual event is not mine. It has become an event of the quizzers themselves. So it has always been a very small, low-scale, self-sustaining effort. Whatever quizzers would pull in, I would give some of my savings that would make it a affair. I would go around and book the auditorium. How quizzing organizations generally happen. So I had to do that. I am not a invitee there, that I will be invited as a quizmaster and everything will be ready. This is not one of those quizzes. This is deeply personal. And now at the end of 2019 edition, it turned out that this quiz is no longer mine. It has become everyone's. And everyone is responsible for making it such a huge affair. And I have been extremely lucky to have received many quizzes. And I remember in one edition, Vikram Joshi also came down. He was in Calcutta for a quiz. He also participated. And it was amazing. And then now I look back and I feel that, you know, these are memories that will probably stay. I had never imagined in 2013 that this would become so big and people would come and appreciate. And, you know, I actually uploaded some of my last past tests on SlideShare as well of Koshi Banerjee Memorial Quiz. And the absolute strangers pinging me and saying that, oh, it was such a nice set. We walked out this, we couldn't get these. But it was so nice to know. I was so happy to see their appreciation of it was beautiful. And now it has, whatever this quiz has stand up to, and it has kind of become in the city, it has become a mainstay in the city quizzing, in the fraternity, in the calendar, it has become a mainstay. So I'm very proud to say the least. It's my baby, it's my product, and I'm extremely happy of how it has shaped up over the years.
Well, of course, this year was an exception, but I'm sure it'll go on for a lot of years after this.
So you talked about how you just manifested your quiz on your own, by your own account, and it has been going for some time now. Do you remember the first ever quiz that you did, or for example, a session or a paid gig and things like that?
See, the first, in my school only, I have hosted a few quizzes for which, of course, I was never paid as such, because it was majorly between inter-house. It was divided in house, and I did that. And one of the memorable ones I had did was among the teachers on Teachers' Day. So I went and asked my headmistress that, you know, can we do a quiz among you people? So they were very receptive. You know, they were very open and with that, and said, oh, why not? Why don't you group us and make teams? It was 4-member teams, there were 7-8 teams. And it was quite successful, you know, that time it was a new thing that happened in school. I made the questions, and then I borrowed somebody's, there was a sort of a small recorder sort of thing on a laptop where you can actually play the AV clues by inserting a CD. So back around the time, there was no PPT as such, and we have managed to do that, and it was very, very successful. So that was the first ever quiz. I remember taking an initiative of my own and doing one. The first ever paid quiz happened when I think I, So this is in 2016 when Exabyte, which is essentially St. Xavier's College, they had a computer science department, their annual fest. They invited me over and for a general quiz. And the reason I remember it more, because I had just finished the quiz and then I went to Delhi for the DQC quiz. So yeah, it was in 2016. So the fact that that's why I was saying, yeah, I was, the reason I used to remember it because I had to finish it in a particular time, so that I had to rush to the station to catch my train to Delhi. So this is how it was. It became, and after that, you know, people kind of called me up. There were a few. I hosted lots of schools, colleges, as well as quizzes for corporate. So this is how it happened. And then I tried to kind of, I was invited to do some quizzing workshops as well. For school students and all that. So it has been pretty memorable since then.
All right. So it's interesting to note all great Samanvay stories starts with Samanvay having an idea and just going up to the person, and it always ends up in yes. So probably his charm, which works on everyone.
Absolutely no. So these are all fake news, nothing like that. But yes, that's what I'm saying. You know, I have been extremely lucky to have known people who I've never imagined would be of so much help. For example, I cannot just walk up to somebody and say, just, can you just give me a job? Because, you know, I have these qualifications or this is something I can do. I can never do that. That's what I was saying, that I've never submitted a CV for my job. But all these people, they have been extremely generous and they've been very kind. For some reason, they thought that I could pull that off or I could do this thing. And somehow it happened. And everything, again, if you are going back to 2014-15, I would have never kind of predicted that these things would happen in the next 3-4 years.
All right. So now we have a fair share of idea about your Quizmaster journey. But who have been your favorite Quizmasters over the years?
Too many personal favorites, but let me figure. Okay, I'll zero in on two people who I really look up to as quizmasters. One, and I have reasons as well. So one of them is, of course, Joy Bhattacharya. I have been to many of his quizzes in Calcutta, and he has been around for quite some time in the fraternity. He has also started, you know, kind of researching for other quizmasters and then become a huge name in his field. And the other one is, of course, Dr. Naveen Jayakumar. Also, the reason I look up to them, both of them, is because, see, their quizzing journey started when they were in their college time. That, around that time, the pattern of quizzing was completely different. So it underwent a sea change in terms of question, content, length, everything, right? And how it is done. Everything has become completely different. Like it has changed pounds and bounds with these, everything has come up. But the way they have adapted themselves to the formats, to the change, and they are still relevant as quizmasters, prove that, you know, they have their first quiz is probably in the 80s as a quizmaster. But even in 2000, when I'm talking about in 2020, Dr. Naveen Jayakumar still does an annual edition of Landmark, which is, I don't know, it is probably the most beautiful quiz to just sit through, even if you do not know anything or whatever. Even if you watch videos of it, even if you watch the set, it's too much of a lovely thing, right? So similarly goes to Joyda as well. He has been around with us in Calcutta especially, because Calcutta, we already have a name for that cold styles, right? So just to go from there and to do quizzes which are, you know, of optimum length, with sufficient clues, and his hosting is so wonderful that even if you go there and sit quietly as an audience, you would enjoy a 2 hour evening. That's why I really look up to them. I have seen other quizmasters making good content, or some other people who are hosting it good, but a combination of everything that makes quizzing palatable to newer audiences is something we should learn from Joyda and Naveen in particular.
So Samanvay, we had asked you to help us, as in one of the formats that we are following across our episodes is we are asking our guests to share a few questions, and you said you'll have a few recent questions that you have created. So could you go ahead and please share the
A shop in Hong Kong has started selling gelato of a special flavor. In developing the recipe, the owners experimented with wasabi and mustard, but ultimately settled on roasted and ground black peppercorns to create the feeling of a slight irritation. So what is unique about this special flavor keeping up with the time?
Yeah, I was in this quiz, so I will refrain. Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah. So yeah, since we can go ahead, so I'll just clue you in. So think about the fact that black peppercorn is used, and if you know what has been going on in Hong Kong, you would understand that this kind of makes the entire approach a unique one of its kind.
So this is related to the Hong Kong protests of pepper spray?
Okay, pepper spray. Can you improve your answer? Pepper spray is something I was looking. Okay, can you just improve your answer? What would protesters be subjected to mostly? Apart from pepper spray, of course.
Tear gas?
Yes, absolutely correct. So this is a tear gas flavored gelato that has actually come up in Hong Kong, and black peppercorns are added just to give a choking sensation. Mm. Right. So this has recently been, you know, and some shops in Hong Kong has recently come up, and with such a flavor. And the best part is Umbrella Revolution about Hong Kong when it was first started. The reason Umbrella Revolution is called Umbrella Revolution, because these protesters used to carry an umbrella, and that used to act as a shield against these tear gas canisters and whatever police used to throw at them. Right. So this is exactly how the concept of Umbrella Revolution came about. So that's a very nice answer, Prithvi. I'll move on to the next question. Okay. A few months back, the Korea Herald reported that the South Korean government, Korea Energy Foundation, and the Seoul Metropolitan Government will offer 3.2 million won per household to enhance heating system, replace floors, and install air conditioners, dehumidifiers, ventilators, windows, and fire alarms to 1,500 families who make less than 60% of the median income. Now, so from Hong Kong, we go to Korea. So what is specifically responsible for bringing about this change in the housing reform in South Korea? Okay, so think about what happened in recent times that something prompted a change in the housing reform in South Korea, right? People who make less than 60% of the median income, their residence or the way they stay will grossly, will hopefully improve in a few months or a few years. So what brought about this change?
Is this Parasite, the movie?
Perfect answer, Prithvi. Excellent. So this is indeed Parasite. So you have seen Parasite. This is exactly what a film can do. It's changing a reform in a country. It's bringing about a political reform in a country. That is exactly how strong a movie can be. That is the strength of the visual medium. Parasite won an Oscar, and look how it's bringing a change in South Korea. That's a brilliant answer. We have all seen, most of us have seen Parasite, but this is something I read up and I figured out that, so this will probably make a decent question. I'll move on to the third one. Okay. This is moving to another geographical part, which is France. So whatever territory that is France, it shares its second and third longest border with Belgium and Spain at 659 and 623 kilometers respectively. So with which country does it share its longest border at 730 kilometers? So think about why will I ask this question and read the question carefully. You would get an idea. So with which country does France share its longest border?
Yeah, I know the funda because this is an overseas territory which is not in mainland France. But I can't remember the exact place.
Okay. So I think you've got your funda correct. This is what happens when you are in a team that would help you work out the answer. So this is Brazil because of French Guiana. Yeah. So Brazil is some 1,000 kilometers away from France, but yet Brazil shares its border with French Guiana as a result of which France actually shares its longest border with Brazil. Okay, so this is also I think one of the recent funda that I came across, and I thought I would put it into a question. All right, moving to the next question. Yeah, so in April 2020, so this ad agency called Macken Biograd came up with some simple, powerful, and brilliant campaign of outdoor ads to heighten the effect that not all heroes wear capes. This was a series of close-up photographs of a particular set of professionals stressing on an occupational hazard in these times. Now, what was the campaign all about? If you come close, I'll give it to you. Just think about what can the campaign specifically be. It was April 2020, particular set of professionals, an occupational hazard that they were undergoing. These are all close-up photographs
Are these the healthcare workers?
Okay, so what about them? What exactly were they highlighting? So it's a very close-up photographs. Not all heroes wear capes.
Because they wear those masks and PPE kits, so something to do with that. So they would not wear.
I think I'll give it to you. What an answer! So this is exactly this is the concept. So when you take out the mask or the kit that has been given to you, so when you take them out, it kind of leaves a deep impression on your face. Those pictures were viral. So this ad agency put a spin to that and made it about superheroes. And this is why the concept came out that not all superheroes wear capes. That's a lovely answer, Prithvi. And okay, I'll move on to the final one as of now. Okay. Yeah. So this is a Harrison Ewing photograph. Well, being on the other side of the spectrum this time, here is someone seen receiving something from Assistant Secretary of Commerce. So who? The person who in quotes? And what is he receiving? I think Abhinav can answer this. I don't think he has seen
it. Yeah, I have not seen this question.
Okay, good. So this is a 1927 photograph. See the look. Take a look at the person receiving. And the fact that he is receiving something makes him belong to the other side of the spectrum this time. So I have blanked out significantly. Also the fact that I am asking about someone in quotes. So,
is there? I don't know. I had a guess. This is not Howard Carter, no. Basically,
no, so the fact that who is in quotes, right? So that should help you. Why will I ask this question? That should help.
So, which is what I was saying. Is this a? So basically, Tutankhamun who is getting his passport and things like that, or another mummy? No.
Okay, not a mummy. If I may say that he can, so whatever he is receiving will help him in his occupation, that will help him in his activity that he carries out every year. Every year at a certain particular time of the year, this guy carries out something and whatever document he is receiving will help him carry out that.
Nansen. No, you won't write who in quotes.
So this is also the fact that it's a black and white image is a red herring.
Oh, okay. What 1927? Prithvi, what are you thinking?
So a colorized photo would have given it away, which is why the fact that it's a black and white image is helping.
Okay. Let's think. Color, what would give away the color?
Take a look at his attire.
It looks like Chinese attire.
Yeah.
I was looking at the same.
1927. So it's a red herring.
Okay, Mao Zedong. No, why would it be who in quotes? Terracotta Warrior. I don't know.
I'll just pass then.
Let me show you the answer then. So this is Santa Claus receiving pile of license.
Nice.
So he is carrying his gifts on the left hand and from the right hand he is receiving his license.
Okay.
These were the five questions that I had.
Thank you, Samanvel, for those questions. Really enjoyable.
Yeah. So back to our usual line of questioning. Since you've already told us that you've interacted with children, so have you seen any myths among parents who advise their children to take up quizzing as a hobby or push their children towards quizzing?
See, in many parts of the country, it's still a prevalent belief that quizzing actually helps you crack government exams. Okay. Which is to a certain extent true because we believe that whatever general knowledge questions that government exams throw, these are similar to what quiz questions we see. It is a bit of a myth because we would know that, you know, these are not exactly the kind of content that we essentially deal with, right? So the thing is that the problem where it happens, I'll tell you that. See, when parents believe that, you know, these things will help my children to crack an exam, that is essentially hinting at the goal-centric approach of the procedure. So the idea should be process-centric and not goal-centric. So the idea should be that you should instill a certain sense of curiosity to your children. And curiosity and any kind of knowledge is essentially compound interest. So it grows exponentially over years, and that might help that particular child who was then small, when he's growing up, that will probably help him understand his own niche himself. So that is what curiosity should do, rather than, you know, you would probably expect, okay, the only reason I'm telling my son or my daughter to take up quizzing is because at one point of time it would help for him or her to get a government job is a bit of a myth out there. Let me put it that way. I'm not saying it doesn't help at all, because if it any curious person, he might not be a quizzer, it helps in every sphere of life for a curious person to excel. So that has nothing to do with quizzing per se, and that has nothing to do with government jobs per se. Right. So this is, I think, a prevalent myth. I believe in a few years this will probably go away a bit. Study says, or my introspection says, that this will probably
I think it
go
is
away
also because many. So to an outsider, to a non-quizzer, they don't understand. Until you get to a quiz, you don't know what the quizzing is about. They think it's about people asking you general knowledge, which is why they have that perception that it could help you. It probably could, but I completely agree with your point.
My point was that, you know, say for example, we know a few people in the quizzing circuit itself that they have been through government jobs and all. They are all employed now in the government, be it state or be it central. But my personal assessment says that they could have probably excelled in other fields as well, given their inherent, you know, curiosity, or given their inherent knack towards acquiring knowledge. Right. So that is a very it's a special bank. Knowledge is a beautiful bank to store things. And especially in today's world, you know, going after the right facts is, of course, important.
Also, it's a very Indian-centric thing to not respect a hobby in the truest sense. Like,
perfect.
You have perfect. To have
kya milega? Kya milega?
What's the profit?
That's what I'm saying. You know, it's everything is goal-centric. So if it happens, everything is goal-centric, then it's probably a little difficult. But as I'm saying, you see, when I'm sure these generation of people will also become parents at one point of time. I'm not too sure whether they'll be doing the same thing with their children or not, but I hope they won't.
Yeah, okay. So, Samanmay.
Yeah.
So, what, plain and simple, what do you like about quizzing? What is it that you have stayed with it for so long?
Well, what not to like about quizzing? That's the first question. But yeah, I get you. See, when I first joined quizzing, it was just out of a natural curiosity to go and attend quizzes. All right. So I was not too well versed with the intricacies and the world of quizzing per se. And that I have started, as I have mentioned earlier, I had started quizzing in the suburbs, you know. And the thing is that it's almost like, say, South Calcutta is almost like that Swarg Lok, and North Calcutta is like the Dharti Lok. And you beyond the city underbelly, beyond Calcutta, there's a greater Calcutta, which is the Patal Lok of quizzing, right? So we can talk about that. But the thing is, see, the way I when I kind of interacted with the other people or other folks from the fraternity, and a genuine bond home was created, you know. So this is what will probably stay. No matter how much podiums I finish on, or podium finishes I make, or no matter how much quizzes I win or whatever, is probably immaterial in terms of the human interaction that quizzing has given me. All right. So coming from a very small city, when we have very limited interaction with people, your circle is almost same every time. And it happened to me till class 12, till 10 fully, and somehow till class 12 only. That when I was kind of forced to the entire sea of quizzing, and not only in Calcutta, then I went to other cities as well to quiz. And when it slowly transferred into hosting, I was invited to other states. I've been to not only in various parts of Bengal, I've been invited to other states to host quizzes as well for organizers. So that, the you know, you get to learn, you get to not only the fact that, you know, they have their own culture and they have their own people, nothing that, but also the fact that they are all entirely new set of people with a completely different approach towards life. And there's a completely different vibe than you were kind of were brought up into. So, and this is a very strong addiction to actually leave, you know. The idea about that, you know, you go there and people are actually paying you to come, and they are booking your hotels, they are getting your flights done, you get to travel at their cost, and I thought it's a wonderful idea, right? Like I cannot stay at my home for more than 3 months. I believe that, you know, if 3 months ho gaya to ab bag uthao chalna shuru karo. Okay, so this is
when are you breaking your lockdown then?
My lockdown, you don't tell me, yaar. And the worst part is that my mom is saying ki ye saal to theek hai, agla saal bhi gaya, and she is very cool with that. Are ye saal to chhodi do, agla saal bhi gaya. I'm like, theek hai, fine. And even say, for example, when you are like as a quizzer, when you are traveling, so we make some quizzing trips as well, not specifically to go in and attend the quiz, but a few friends, a few of us who travel together. So maybe in 2017 we went to Vizag, the next year we went to Goa, and sometimes to North Bengal in Darjeeling. We make an annual trip to a sea beach town in West Bengal. These are just plain quizzing trips. Some quizzing buddies are there. We make our own sets as well sometimes, just to run in at night or, you know. So that amount of fun, you know, and the best part is that they are nowhere close to my age. When I first went in around 2016-17, none of them were students, all of them were possibly graduated, and most importantly, most of them were professionals, full-time professional life, all married people and all, they were also there, right? So the idea of that, you never feel alienated with your own kin, it's a beautiful feeling that you are not, you know, you have always, you feel like you are one of the herd. So that is such a beautiful, beautiful feeling, and that kind of translated when I had started hosting quizzes, not only on-ground quizzes, but also TV shows and the other kind of content that I have made and the other places that I have got to work through quizzing. So all these have been a gateway to a vast world for which I had no theoretical knowledge, right? So you cannot really learn these things in a university, in an institution, but these are things like probably give it to you and as a sort of a Pandora's box, and only in a better sense of the term. All right, so I'm sure as a hobby, just like every other hobby, quizzing too probably has its own limitation, but on a whole, I personally feel extremely fortunate to have probably taken up this hobby along with my curricular activities, I'm along with my studies and all, like the fact that I could somewhat continue, and the fact that my, you know, family were very welcome to do all these things, do whatever you like, even do whatever you feel like. The fact that I have been so sort of given that amount of independent space. So, you know, quizzing has been kind of, what can I say, it's very difficult to explain in a sentence, but it's an entire world sort of to me. And the amount of the reciprocation, the respect, the recognition I've got through quizzing. And I believe that I'm very lucky, even at my age, I have actually seen some beautiful, beautiful people in the fraternity. All right. And they are probably like 100 times better quizzer than I am. But at the same time, the fact that, you know, I could still be one of them without any sort of prejudices or whatsoever makes me it's a wonderful, wonderful feeling.
All right. And on the other end of the spectrum, what do you dislike about quizzing? What would you like to change about the current state of quizzing?
See, well, two things that come to my mind ideally. First, this is something which has been a subject of lots of debates and discussions, especially in the last few years or so, that I still believe for some reason there hasn't been enough women representation in quizzing, right? The reason I'm saying so, and this is not an umbrella statement as such. When I'm kind of invited to schools or, you know, middle schools or high schools to host quizzes, and this is not only about West Bengal, this is across the country, I see that, you know, there are many all-girl teams, or, you know, even in co-educational schools, there are too many girl teams that are doing extremely well in the quiz. Not only in the prelims, they do well in the finals, not only in terms of podium finishes, but their approach to an answer, their analytical thinking, they have been excellent, you know, praiseworthy throughout. But my question was that why isn't it getting translated in the later years? I can understand, of course, it's very difficult to lead especially in India, it's very difficult to be a woman. You know, this is something I can understand. But apart from that, there are maybe it's probably us, maybe even I am equally complicit in certain way, that they are not getting translated as a whole sort of representation in the fraternity. Yeah, I think are slowly changing, probably for the better. The number of teams have of late increased slightly, but I would love to see too many people joining in, and there should be a forum or a voice so that their voices are heard and are respected, and kind of, you know, things are sort of changed in their favor. All right. So there are certain reasons, of course, probably it's not possible for them to open up every time. But I'm sure there are some things for which, even if they are alienated, and that's what I was telling, even if I'm remotely complicit, that's what makes me sort of guilty in a way. But whatever, I am sure for one person like me, probably not possible to change everything. But whatever little I can contribute towards the thing. This is the first one. The second one is a little bit personal and it's a bit city oriented, that, you know, a Calcutta cuisine style has kind of gathered a negative term called cold style cuisine, right? So this has been since the 80s, and the fact that it's still there only proves that things people probably couldn't kind of we couldn't get it to a positive spin. But my take, my two bits on this is that, see, I can understand this entire gharana of kitchen questions and all, that's a different format altogether. That is not cold style. The fact that you are asking one-liner questions without any, I can understand it's a plain fact-based questions without any hints is a cold style. If that is, I have seen very eminent quizmasters outside Calcutta doing lot of text swirl and all without a single extractable hint. Okay, so this is throughout the country. I am not zeroing on a specific region. This is throughout the country. So my only point is the way quizzing is, if you take a look at the future of quizzing, my take is that, and with our attention span and all, how digital world has completely engulfed us, my take is that cold styles might be the future of quizzing. By cold styles, I mean 280 characters, a Twitter length question, which are short, compact, with ample hints to work out. This might be the future of quizzing as I believe it to be, because there are reasons as well. Because, you know, we cannot interest quizzers, new quizzers, to come up if they see such huge long textual. Reading textual and reading a long form article is a completely different issue. When you are reading a long form article, there is no such takeaway of the fact that you have to finish reading this question in a stipulated time. And then you have to discuss with your teammates, and then you have to pound. There's no such baggage with long-form articles. But with such textual-based questions, there are certain limitations that come around. And I believe, I have no problem with textual as long as there are hints. I believe that small, short, compact questions is probably, you know, is the future. Given that is the reason why in television shows also, when we are said to what, we are told specifically to frame the question in the shortest compact manner possible, in a stipulated character bit. So these are two things that I really want, that if we could change, if there's a bit of a change that can happen through this, I would really love that. You know, I'm against any sort of labeling as such in quizzes.
I think we have to look at quizzing during this COVID world. We don't know.
Right.
For how long this will go on. So I think that is a very good point to put forward.
I'll just tell, from my experience, I can tell you one thing, is that, you know, it's probably more difficult to frame a compact question, right?
Absolutely.
What I believe is it's a little difficult to make a question completely, you know, every fact will be there, and the fact that you can still extract it. What would you do in case you are supposed to face the same question? So this is a kind of a thing that we should really look at.
Which is why amateur quizzes, you see a lot of long text questions. We've had a few guests talking about the same, that they had initial quizzes were long text, and then they learned to put it into a smaller compact packet. I think that is...
I'm also guilty. Let me put my hands over and say that I'm also guilty of the same. I have done that in my, you know, in my previous quizzes. At first, I thought that, okay, textual is the only solution to cold style questions. This is an idea that has completely been a myth for me. And then I figured out that as soon as that is also a better part of, you know, getting to host quizzes, when you understand that you cannot really throw a textual question to school students. At the end of the day, you have to make it very simpler for them. That concept should go along with schools to colleges to corporates across in every level, right? This is my two bits on this.
I think the first time me and Samanvay met was in IIT Kanpur, and I was about to say that the questions, I'm really embarrassed now, and I've taken them out of my SlideShare account completely. But at that point, I was really proud of those fundas and all those long text questions. So when you grow as a quizmaster, you realize that there's a lot of clutter there, and which doesn't need to be there for the question to work.
Absolutely, that has every your content, your product has to be clutter free. It has to be free of complexity. This is what I look at. And I was about to tell about the Antaragni bit as well. What I really liked around that time, I remember, was that I think you did two quizzes, Bollywood and India. So after the India quiz, one very good thing that I knew about, I was seeing Prithvi for the first time, and he came up to us and said that, you know, is there any feedback that you have, any feedback, any sort of feedback that you want to give me to improve my quizzes? So I was little unhappy with the way Bollywood quiz surfaced, but I was very happy with the way India quiz was done. I absolutely liked it. So I said to him, you know, on spot, that, you know, I think your Bollywood quiz might have these things, but your India quiz was fascinating. It was superb. It's beautiful content, you know. Exactly how an India quiz should be, getting every basis, everything was very nice. So the fact that, you know, that he was a stranger, and at that moment that he could give me a space for me to give that feedback, yet our relations have not turned sour, proves that, you know,
yes, that is a very important characteristic to have as a human being, not just as a quiz master. Yeah, as a human being.
Absolutely.
To take criticism and,
perfect. So that helps you in your trade, right? You get a customer rating, right? You when you were ordering stuff from Amazon, you give a customer rating, right? Similar, I treat my product as the same way.
And I think Samanvay has helped me out with all those errors a lot of times. Like, I remember recently for a quiz, I had put in Vijay Hazare's photograph for Devdhar, and he was nice enough to point it out so I could save it in time.
See, even if there were other people, I wouldn't have, you know, kind of bothered myself to go and check. The fact that I know that, you know, we have that space between us where I can actually, even if I am factually incorrect sometimes, I'm sure people would point me out. I'm sure you would also point me out that, you know, your question is slightly wrong, or can you just change that. All right. So these are, what can I say, all personal spaces that happen. But the fact that we were complete strangers when we met, not that we used to go to schools or colleges together, not that we are from the same culture, not that we're from the same geography, yet we can mingle, and that's the beauty of the fraternity, I believe.
Yeah, so I think that brings us to the end of the fifth episode of Whose Question Is This? Thank you, Samanvay, for being so gracious and so generous with your anecdotes. As in, we have so much of content to put through. It's really going to be one of the better episodes for sure. Thank you for your time, Prithvi.
Thank you. It has been an absolute pleasure. Thank you so much for thinking of me to invite in this episode. It has been an absolute pleasure for me.